Hello, good morning. It is Monday the 6th of August, and with everything that has been going on over the last couple of weeks, I think the only word to kind of like describe it is shell-shocked. I mean, I know we've had incidences in the United Kingdom in the past where we, you know, there's been riots and antisocial behaviour, mainly, you know, in and around London. But the fact that it seems to be getting worse all over the country is quite worrying. And I think the only time it really kind of affects you personally as an individual is when it happens locally in your hometown or happens to you. Now, I've just put a post on my YouTube channel. It's a poll, and it's basically regarding respect. You know, there are three options. And basically, my question to people that are following me or anyone who wants to answer, bearing in mind legally you can't have a YouTube account until you're 18, is respect for others. You know, should it just be granted that you respect other people regardless of who they are? Or does respect have to be earned? Or does it depend on the circumstances? Now, yesterday, I would like to say, was a brilliant day, which it was. We started off in the morning. By the afternoon, I could barely walk, but that's beside the point. We went to the local car boot sale. I took my children to a local park in a nearby village to where I live. And one of the things that we tend to do a lot with the kids, or should I say their dad does, is he'll take them to different parks in and around Nuneaton and in and around Warwickshire. And it is just absolutely amazing to see how each park is so different. I'm not just talking about, obviously, the way that it's laid out or the structures or the play equipment, but the actual people that are using those facilities. Now, we have an area in Nuneaton called Camp Hill. It has a very negative outlook in, you know, within Nuneaton. If you say, oh, Camp Hill, people say Tramp Hill. Oh, you don't go to Camp Hill, you'll get killed, you'll get knifed, you'll get stabbed. You know, the kids up there are little shitheads. You know, there's nothing ever positive about that area. And yet there are people in Camp Hill that are trying to sort of improve the area. And one of the reasons why there's a lot of sort of antisocial behaviour up there and a lot of negative about Camp Hill is because the Nuneaton and Bedworth Borough Council, in their pearls of wisdom, over a decade ago now, it's probably over 20 years ago now, decided they were going to do what was called a regeneration project in Nuneaton. So what they did was they compulsory purchased everybody's houses in Camp Hill, knocked them all down, and then rebuilt these like barrack homes. And they're all different colours, and it is literally like being in Ballymore. And a lot of the people, if you actually speak to them, that had their houses compulsory purchased are now being forced into rented accommodation. They said with what the government paid them for their houses, they could never rebuy another property. They couldn't even buy a new house that was being built. So that's one of the reasons why Camp Hill has a lot of negativity. There's also some social housing up there. And we have what is called the Chess Centre, which is a community centre, where there are people there that work and are really, really, really trying with the young people. And we went to the park there a couple of weeks back, and the children there were absolutely amazing. They were so polite, they were so kind, they were so generous. There was a little girl, she was running around giving people flowers, wishing everybody a happy day. And she literally was just so lovely in her outlook in life. We went to a park yesterday in Ansley Village again. clean, no broken glass. The children there were happy. The whole atmosphere was just laughter. All you could hear was children laughing and playing, and it was just absolutely beautiful. Then, in the evening, my children decided they wanted to go to the skate ramp park, which is literally only 5 minutes away from where they live. And so they went down on their scooters, they were happy, they wanted to play. I met them later, and the attitude of this park, which is literally 5 minutes away from where we live, there's broken glass, there's marijuana, there's drug packets, there's Nitrox bottles. Half of the play equipment is broken, and you're there with the kids trying to have a nice afternoon, just before bedtime. And the children, unfortunately, in that park were stealing people's bikes, stealing people's scooters. And the moment you basically were saying, "Excuse me, that's not yours, that's my child's, give it back," and I obviously didn't get, I wasn't there, I didn't get involved with that part of the day. But the moment you're like, "Okay, guys, let's go home, it's getting a bit late now, let's go to bed," and then out of the blue, young people are swearing at you. And I think it's total and utter like disbelief that you're there with your 5-year-old, my son's 9 today, it's his birthday, and your 10-year-old and their dad, who is 6 foot odd, and all of a sudden, out of the blue, you're hearing, "Oh, you ginger fat cunt." And you're like, No, I'm hearing things. There's no way I'm in a park with children who are between the ages of 8 and 11, and you're hearing that kind of language. Especially after I've been to parks where, you're told, "Oh, don't go to that park. The kids are little bastards. They're likely to pull a knife on you." And you go to the park and you're fine. Or you go to another park and all you can hear is children laughing and screaming with glee, to then be 5 minutes away from where you live and hearing that kind of language. And you're thinking, "Oh no, they can't possibly be talking to me. I can't possibly be having some stranger's child who's down the local park by themselves with their friends, swearing at me when they don't even know who I am. I don't even know who they are." And you're kind of thinking, no, I've not heard these words. I'm hearing things. Maybe they're just talking to each other. Maybe they're talking to somebody on the phone." To then hear it again. And again, and again, and again, and again, to the point where I was like, "Excuse me, can you not do that, please? I'm with my 5-year-old. Can you have some respect?" And then to hear it again, and you think to yourself, "Right, I'm not going to get involved. I'm just going to leave. I'm going to get away from these children." To then have them follow you home to the point where I'm literally having to turn around with my phone in my hand, with my camera on, and saying to them, "Right, do you want to repeat what you've just called me? And if you follow me home, I'm phoning the police." I mean, it's just absolutely like surreal that anyone would have to endure that kind of treatment. And with everything else that's obviously been going on since those young girls were murdered, I mean, I've not heard anything else on the news from the police as to who was responsible or whether they've been formally charged or nothing. And yet people seem to be taking the law into their own hands and making assumptions as to what's actually happened or who was responsible. And I just think to myself, what has society become? I mean, in my hometown, Nuneaton, when we used to live on the boat full time, we always moored in Nuneaton because it was our hometown. But we always knew where not to moor. And yet, if you was to speak to anyone who lives on a canal boat, anyone at all, and you said to them, what do you think of the Coventry Canal Network? They will tell you the same thing. They will say, do not ever moor in Nuneaton. Do not ever moor anywhere along the Coventry Canal Network. Because if you do, your boat, when you get back to it, isn't going to be there. You know, or if it is there, you know, your windows are going to be smashed or it's going to be graffitied. You know, there's nothing positive about the Coventry Canal Network. And I can totally agree because we've been victims of assault on the canal. And again, it was in Coventry Canal, it was at the Grand Union as well. And you think to yourself, you know, when you can't even walk down the road without being abused or assaulted, I'm not talking physically, I'm talking verbally. I mean, I'm not saying that people haven't been assaulted physically in my hometown. Apparently, Arbury Road, near where I live, is one of the biggest crime areas at the moment. So it's not even Camp Hill anymore, where I have actually walked to my doctor's surgery in Camp Hill, and I've seen the forensics teams in their white coats, in their white, you know, not like on NCIS where they're there in like their Prada suits or anything. Literally, where they've got the tent up outside somebody's house, everybody's all in white. The police have barricaded off the entire area. And yeah, I have actually physically seen that in Camp Hill, which is supposed to be one of the worst areas of Nuneaton. And yet now, it's not. You know, it's Stocking Ford, it's Abbey Green, it's Nuneaton Town Centre. And people are complaining about how Nuneaton Town Centre is a ghost town. Of course, it's going to be a ghost town. Who on earth in their right mind is going to want to go to a town centre where young people think that it's acceptable behaviour to murder a fully grown man by stabbing him to death outside McDonald's, which is like the only place in town that's still open? And so, I mean, I'm not talking about, you know, people being murdered in Gaza or anywhere else. I'm talking about my hometown being somewhere, just like where those poor innocent girls in Stockport were murdered. This is actually happening on my doorstep, and I'm pretty sure if you speak to anyone, it is sick and sad to think this isn't just happening where I live, this is happening everywhere. And I think as a society, we need to think to ourselves, why? Why is this happening? And people can say, oh, it's all because of all these bloody illegal immigrants coming into the country. No, the people that have been stabbed and murdered in my hometown have not been stabbed and murdered to my aunt, to my knowledge, by illegal immigration. They have been stabbed and murdered by people that know them, or people that, just like these young children in that park yesterday that I went to with my kids, have been taught, or not been educated, shall I say, that you do not start swearing at complete strangers and calling people, oh, you fat, ugly, ginger cunts. And I had to say something to them. I had to say, look, you need to be careful. You are so lucky that you've actually accused said that to me. Because if you had gone and said that to somebody else, you probably wouldn't be standing there right now. Because if it had been somebody else, maybe in another area of town or even in that park, and those young kids had said that to someone else, and I even had to say this to the police, it probably would have been on the 6 o'clock. Well, it wouldn't have been on the 6 o'clock news because it was after 7. But by 9 o'clock the following morning, you probably would have heard how there'd been a knife attack, or that somebody in the Stockingford wreck in Nuneaton had been put in hospital or was dead. And 9 times out of 10, you probably would have heard on the social media, well, it's just a little bastard's right. I don't want to be blaming, and I don't want to be saying, where do we draw the line and who is responsible? Because at the end of the day, we should all be responsible for our own actions. And I always keep saying to my children, your actions have consequences. You chose to take your scooters to the park. Yes. You shouldn't have been ever put in a situation where other children thought it was acceptable behaviour to try and steal them. But at the same time, like I keep reminding my kids, you chose to take your scooters. Even though I would have said, you have two choices. If you're going to take your scooters, then you don't go and play in the main playground, you play on your scooters and then you go home. But it just proves how, nothing is safe. Life isn't sacred anymore. I don't even know whether it ever really was. Maybe that was just some kind of, rose-tinted aspects that I or opinion that I used to have, that's no longer there. But, to have young people in society being the way they are. I mean, I'm not talking, like I said, about Africa or, Gaza or anywhere else. I'm talking about the United Kingdom. 5 minutes away from where I live, children are thinking that it is okay to have no respect, to verbally abuse, to victimize complete strangers, to steal, to be ex you know to exhibit antisocial behavior and violence. And then 45 minutes away from where I live, people are thinking that it's acceptable behavior to commit murder. So I am worried, I am scared, because in my hometown, I probably shouldn't even mention this, but I'm going to anyway because I think everyone's probably aware. We've just had a new hotel built, and it's cost over £20 million to build this hotel, and it's put Nuneaton and Bedworth in debt of 20 million. And if people are setting hotels in Tamworth on fire, which, let's face it, is probably only about an hour away from where I live if you have a car. How long is it going to be before they get a bee in their bonnet and decide to set this new hotel on fire in Nuneaton? At the moment, it's not even open. There isn't even anyone living there. But there's already all these vicious rumours circulating that it's going to be full of illegal immigrants and migrants and people who are homeless and, a blight on society. Every time I turn on social media, it's the only thing locally that people are moaning about. And it's not just there. There's probably about three or four different places in my hometown that are renowned locally for supporting people who need emergency accommodation. But that does not mean that all of those people are illegal immigrants. They could be women with young children who have been victims of domestic violence. They could be elderly people who have been evicted from the house that they're renting because they can no longer afford the rent because of how much pension they're getting. You just don't know. And, and it doesn't matter who you are, what creed or colour you are. As from a young age, the one thing that I always remember being taught is that life is sacred. If you want to follow the Ten Commandments, that is your choice. But I always, always, always remember being taught that as a child, even though I'm not Christian, I'm pagan. But the one thing where you're always taught is to respect life. And it just seems that most important thing that you're taught or that you teach your children is to have respect for life no longer exists. Or do unto others as you want them to do unto you. Or he without sin may cast the first stone. These are things that I was always under the impression that people were taught. And yet, the only thing people seem to be thinking about right now is an eye for an eye. And again, even William Shakespeare, when you think of the Merchant of Venice, if you cut me, do I not bleed? If you tickle me, do I not laugh? And if you wrong me, I think I can always forget that part. I think it's something like, if you wrong me, do I then not have the right to seek revenge? But I don't know, so don't quote me on that last bit. But the two things that always stick in my mind are, if you cut me, do I not bleed? If you tickle me, do I not laugh? And if that is the case, and the answer is yes, basically trying to say that it doesn't matter what creed or colour you are, we are all the same. I mean, why as a species have we not learned? Why have we not learned from having two world wars? I just, take what you will from this, but I think I am, I'm just shell shocked. I am just shell shocked that we are living in a society where, in my opinion, respect no longer exists. And how can we change that? Thank you.